You know, the month of November, towards the end of the month, we have two big birthdays in our family. Our youngest daughter, Liza Rose, just a few weeks ago, turned 18. Our youngest turned 18. It's a whole new world, people. What? And my beloved sister, practitioner, Kelly Satimo, her oldest daughter turned 8. And so at the Thanksgiving table, when we were done sharing our wonderful meal and our time together, Vivian, the 8-year-old, and her little brother, they made these really cute brownies with very sweet cherry frosting, and it was bright pink. And so Kelly and I had a brownie for each, for Liza Rose and for Vivian. We put a little candle, and before we had the pumpkin pie, we needed to sing them happy birthday. And so I was sitting right across the table. They were sitting right next to each other with this beautiful plate with the cherry sweet brownies and the candles in each, and we were singing them happy birthday. And I had a moment. I had a moment. As I sat across the table, I saw little Vivi, who just turned 8. I watched her come into this world, one of the greatest gifts and memories of my lifetime. And I saw our Liza Rose turn 18. And I recognized in that very moment what a difference a decade makes. And how much had happened in the decade between the time when Liza Rose was 8 and now that she's 18. And I realized in that moment how precious this life is. You know, we say that all the time, but sometimes those life events happen and it just takes us right to this place in our heart where we realize how precious this life is and how we are in such a position, we are so poised, each one of us, to experience the gratitude and the grace that happens each day. As I was sitting there, I was aware that during that decade, there were days when I'm certain I forgot how grateful I am. Anybody? And it gave me pause to consider and really be with this idea that as we move through our lives, a decade, a month, a week, a day, it is our actions that deeply shape that experience or that period of time in our life. However, we don't always necessarily realize it at the time. I certainly know I didn't. Here in New Thought, we realize, we recognize, we teach, and we understand that we are always at choice to choose the actions we take because we have been given this extraordinary gift of free will. In New Thought, we do not subscribe to the idea that there is some sort of, you know, bearded man god puppeteer in the sky with strings like this ruling over our lives. We understand that the strength, the loving power of the divine is within us, is through us, and is as us. And this divine power, if you will, this divine love works through us. It is that divine orchestration that when we realize we are in alignment, it really is like this symphony. It's like this orchestra, and each of us plays our part. We're all part of spirit and one another. There is no separation. This world would have us think that, but there is no separation. We don't believe in the duality of separation. We recognize, understand, and stand in the truth that we are all part of the one. We are all of the one, part of the one. We don't believe in the separation, for example, that there is like some literal hell someplace. We do not subscribe to the idea that there is some sort of separate, like Satan or devil, you know, making us do things. That is an ancient, ancient idea. That is how difficulty and challenge was explained a long, long, long time ago, we have come so far from that level of consciousness. We have grown through that limited consciousness. You know, this whole idea, the devil made me do it, what a cop-out. Seriously, right? It's like zero accountability. Oh, well, that's easy. I'll go to that church. The devil made me do it. Here, this work that we are all engaged in. This is mighty, holy, sacred work. Action by action, choice by choice that we take in this teaching. And when we deeply get that, we deeply get how much we belong to each other. How much our actions have a ripple effect, good, bad, and neutral, on people we don't even know. When we deeply get that our individual choices deeply impact those around us, sometimes for generations, we understand that we have an opportunity to either connect or disconnect with ourselves and others through these choices. And when we understand this, we move differently in the world, choice by choice. So the spiritual principle that I want to talk about today is divine right action. Divine right action. What does that even mean? It sounds very fancy. It's not. It's actually quite simple. In Buddhism, for example, right action is an integral part of the Eightfold Path. To whittle it down and make it just the simplest explanation I can give you, the Buddha taught that in order to be on a true spiritual path, it requires us to live an ethical life. It requires us to do no harm to the very best of our ability. This beautiful concept is echoed not only in Buddhism, but throughout all the great faiths, all the Abrahamic faiths, Judaism, Christianity, Islam. It's also found in Confucianism and Taoism and Sikhism and Baha'i and many others. Living in alignment with divine right action is a powerful choice to make in the world, but it must be conscious. Otherwise, a whole decade can go by. And we look up and we go, huh? What? Who? Where am I? What happened? As the Buddha taught, we're here to be awake. So two weeks ago, I brought you the spiritual practice of what if. That's from a talk called A Time for Light, if you haven't yet seen it. And it's just this idea that if you are feeling in any way worried or fearful or concerned, and it's stopping you from moving forward, there's this spiritual tool of what if. Asking yourself in that moment, what if? And if you do that, it allows this spaciousness. It's like this bridge to get to the next step. So it might look like something, let's say you're afraid about something, afraid of something might happen, and you just stop and say, what if? What if this actually turns out really well? What if the diagnosis isn't the worst? What if I can actually do that thing? What if it works out? What if fill in the blank? Do you remember those of you who saw that? And if not, I invite you into that talk and into that spiritual practice. What if the bridge of stepping out of fear or worry, not la-la-laing it away, pretending it's not there, but simply that hang time, that spaciousness to get to the place of intention, which is what Shelley spoke so beautifully about last week, didn't she? Intention. Shell taught us that in Latin, the word intention means to stretch inward with purpose. In our spiritual teaching, intention is different from a goal. It's not about what I want in the world. It's about who do I want to be in the world, recognizing that as I be, as I become, the spiritual quality of that which I seek, as I remember it within me and express it outwardly, it then can't not come to me. So first it's what if. What if this actually turns out well? Then it's setting this intention. I'm going to stretch inward. with purpose. I'm going to set this intention. And then step three is today. And that is, what action will I take? What action will I take? The great Buddhist monk Thich Nhat Hanh said, "My actions are my only true belongings. My actions are my only true belongings." And the actions that I'm talking about today are actions like choosing forgiveness, choosing kindness, choosing compassion, choosing generosity, choosing love. And the love of spirit invites us into this action every single day. The key word here again is choice. We're always at choice about how we're going to be in the world. So I saw something recently that I just love so much. So during the 17 and under World Cup, this was a couple of years ago, there was a young fellow, 16 years old. His name is Quinlan Roberts. And he was like the sub goalie. Now, I'm not a sports person, so in my world, it's sort of like the understudy going on opening night for Broadway. That's how I understand it. He was the sub goalie. He wasn't supposed to play the game, the soccer or his football as they call it there. It was Canada and England. England was up 1 point. The Canadian goalie got an injury, a knee injury, so they called in Quinlan at the last moment. He's the sub, he's the understudy, right? He goes in, he finds in the very first play, he gets the ball. He goes to kick it, but there's no one to kick it to. There's no one open to kick it to. Here is what he decided to do. Right? Yeah. Let's see it again. So here's how I see it. Quinlan got the ball, because you notice there's a moment, he's waiting. He looks up. There's nobody to kick it to, nobody that's open. Number one, somewhere inside of him, Quinlan had to say, what if? What if? What if I just kick it to the other side of that huge, gigantic field? What if? Second step, he created the intention in that moment. What if I do that? And the intention to stretch inward with purpose. What if I am able, agile, magnificent, strong, and I can do it? And the third is he just kicked the ball. My title for my talk today is called Just Kick the Ball. Just kick the ball. How many times in our lives are we faced with this decision and we wait or we don't kick the ball? I know I have missed many opportunities to do that in my life. Great love. With great love, I share this. This is the place, right? How many times in our lives have we actually kicked the ball, though? Think about that. You know, it looks like many things to many people, this idea. So, my friend, how about if you just kick the ball and ask the person out? How about if you just kick the ball and lay that thing down once and for all? How about if you kick the ball and forgive yourself or that other person finally? How about if you kick that ball and claim your worth by saying yes or by saying no, thank you? How about if you kick that ball and do that thing that has been calling to you from the deepest place within you, whatever that is for you, however small, medium, large, or gargantuan? I'd like to invite you here and those of you at home, if you're willing, to just close your eyes for a moment, turn within. And I invite you to make this real for yourself. Consider for yourself in this moment, where is life or spirit nudging you to just kick the ball? And what is that for you, my love? What is that for you? It may be more than one thing. What is calling forth within you to make that goal, to kick that ball, to experience that love in your life? And now, taking in another deep breath, I invite you to see yourself doing that. See yourself in this moment doing that. And when you are ready, I invite you to open your eyes. Here's some great news. We could all use some great news right now, right? When you take that divine right action in your life, instead of being a bystander, instead of not taking that shot, when you are leading your life with trust that God or Spirit will always assist you, catch you, nudge you, hold you, you are participating in goodness in the world. You are being the change that we all so desperately want to see and be on this planet, even on the smallest level. Even on the smallest level, when you just go for it and kick whatever that ball is in your life, you make your life better, but you also make life better for every single person around you, whether you can see it right now in this moment or not. Because some of those opportunities are challenging and difficult, I know and I understand. How many times have you taken that risk in your life to do that thing that was so hard in the moment, and now you look back on it and you say, oh, thank God, right? And in doing this, you ultimately experience more joy, which, as I mentioned a few weeks ago, right now, joy, claiming our joy, is a revolutionary act. It's revolutionary. And some people would say, oh, that's selfish. Oh, no, it is not. It is absolutely vital. It is vital to the planet right now. We are each one of us a part of this family of life. We are each one of us part of this field of life. Our teaching is ancient wisdom. However, it is grounded very much in modern science and in the present. We understand this life is metaphysical. This teaching is metaphysical. The opportunities we have are metaphysical, beyond the physical. Beyond the physical. Hear me, when, you know, when we choose to kick that ball, even if it is the smallest thing, we are choosing peace, we are choosing love, we are choosing grace, we are choosing God, we are choosing spirit. We are choosing love. And in doing this, we are choosing to be part of the global peace process. We have all kinds of ways in this beloved community, in our spirit-led social action, our global collective social justice work. We have all kinds of things that we can do. Today I'm talking about the actions that we can personally take in our own becoming. With all of the wars and the fighting and the conflict that is happening in the world right now, it is easy to feel helpless. It's easy to feel like, what can I do? And I am here to tell you that every single one of us can do what is ours to do when we choose to kick that ball. We help to make the world a better place, whether we recognize it or not. We did not come here to be stagnant. We did not come here to sit on the sidelines. Rest when you need rest. Replenish when you need to be replenished. And take divine right action when it is calling to you. When you have that opportunity. When you have that opportunity. What a blessing that is. The great Mary Oliver wrote, "There is only one question, how to love this world." There is only one question, how to love this world. When we decide to love our world by being part of the healing process, part of the solution, not the problem, when we decide to include everyone, when we decide to extend the table or the playing field, when we step into the courage to just kick that ball, to move our dial towards a greater experience of self-love and acceptance, we are moving the dial towards outer greater self-love and acceptance. Do you see? When we actively participate in the peace process of our own lives, we support the global peace process on earth. And so whatever it is that is beckoning to you, whatever that is, maybe it's calling that person, returning that call or that email, writing that letter, showing up, or closing the door. When you choose to do this, you are supporting peace on earth. And I don't know about you, but for me, it makes it easier to make that decision. When I realize it's not just about me, how could it be in that moment that every action we choose in the decade, the month, the week, the day of our life, we're creating more peace or not? So this week, I invite you to very gently notice any opportunities in any area of your life, not only the one you just identified, but notice as you move through your week how many opportunities show up for you. You will be amazed when you wake up to it. And if you can anchor your memory with that video, let it buoy you, let it inspire you. Ask yourself, what if? And then set the intention for what you want to be in that moment. And then, my loves, just kick the damn ball. In doing so, you will make a difference. You will make a difference. And there will be more love on earth.